Good morning to everyone who is watching Wilder TV this morning. Today you'll have Sam Chevalier as your presenter and Viem behind the camera. It's been a while since I've been with Viem. He's been on holiday, well, just a couple days of holiday. So it's great to have Viem back behind camera. We have Louise as director and Rebecca as D2. So we've just seen three hyenas running straight past us here, and they've gone what looks like towards the den. So I've decided we're going to go round and see if we can catch up on those hyenas that have just sprinted through the bush here. It's already started off to an interesting morning, as we heard that the Mangen pride was seen in this area just over there. So maybe they're running from a kill or something like that. But let's go and have a look first at what those hyenas are doing. Are they at the den? Because if they are at the den, then we could possibly see maybe if they've taken a kill back, or if they've got blood on their face or anything like that. It might tell us a story of what has been happening this morning. And then we'll come back down here towards Sydney's Dams, where we are at, and have a look to see if there's anything or any track marks of lines that have crossed over into the area. So let's start off with some active hyenas. And these are the times of the day when it's best to see hyena, because they're more active in the mornings at dusk and at dawn. Dawn and dusk is when you are often find some hyenas. What are you seeing there, Viem?
Leopard tracks.
So Viem has just seen some leopard tracks. Let's have a look. What direction are they going?
Yeah.
They're going that way.
Yeah, but they're not here.
Okay, cool. Let's just go up to the den. The den's not far away from here. We're going to come back down to Sydney. Looking very relaxed over here. There's an alarm call in the parlor that I can hear. So it's going to be another breathtaking sunrise here at Juma. Let's carry on going. Let's have a look here. Maybe they are looking at something. Doesn't seem to be anything over there. Some female impala to the left of us here, strutting off. Their warm coats on. It's been a cold night. Are they looking at something? Let's just look in that direction. Doesn't seem like it. They were just looking off there. All right, so we're not far from the den. Let's keep going. I'm feeling a little bit better this morning. I was feeling quite sick last night. Not sick, I just had like those flu-y kind of headaches you get. I definitely wasn't dehydrated. I was drinking a lot of water. So I'm definitely feeling a little bit better. So we're off to the den. We're gonna get there as soon as possible. In the meantime, let's go and see how Brent is doing. Good morning and welcome to a chilly sunrise safari. The light is rising in the east and we are heading due east at the moment. So we saw Karula on our way back from Cheetah Plains last night, and fingers crossed she's popped along our eastern boundary. Jandre and I are heading there. And of course, my name is Brent, for those who don't know. But we're hoping to find either tracks of Karula or the Nkahumas in this area. If we have no luck, we will then be beetling even further east towards the plains of the cheetah to see if we can follow up on those two male cheetah and the Birmingham boy we saw on yesterday's sunset safari. But I do love these early mornings, and I'm hoping to find some kitty cats basking in the glorious early morning light in a little while. Just checking carefully in the headlights for any tracks. Nothing so far. Now, as I understand, Mr. Tingana hasn't been seen in quite a while either.
I wonder where he's off patrolling. There's always a strong possibility in this area that we might come across some of his tracks as he goes on his patrols. He does have an incredibly large territory that he defends, all the way from the western edge of the Sabi Sands around the gate, right down to Cheetah Plains, and encompassing most in between. Almost palpable excitement as we get out in the early morning, a fresh canvas for us to look at. And hopefully the kitty cats have been walking around. And as it gets drier, it's going to become easier and easier for us to see the tracks, and should hopefully put our cat sightings up a little bit. Unfortunately, not too cold yet. It was around 63 odd Fahrenheit this morning. So it hasn't dropped below that really cold threshold. No need for gloves just yet. But one of these mornings, we are going to get one of those ones that drop below 10 degrees Celsius. And I might be a little bit miserable. I might be talking to you like this through a muffled thing to try and keep my nose warm. I think that's one of the ones that irritates me the most when it's really cold. The tip of your nose gets very, very, very cold. Of course, because it's cartilage, not a lot of capillaries there, so there's no blood moving around to warm it up. Curtis in Virginia says he's excited to see leopard, but is really hoping for wild dog. Curtis, I go out every morning and every afternoon hoping for wild dog. I'm going to see what that was in the road there. Ah, it looked like a bit of dung in the early morning light. However, it is not. It is some form of strap that has fallen off some form of vehicle. It looks like an old seatbelt. Well, definitely not from our vehicles. We don't have any, but there we go. We don't want seatbelts lying around in the bush. Quite often, if Karula comes through from Torchwood, she'll come through onto this road, Drakensberg Road, and she does like to hunt in these thickets around here. But so far, no tracks. This is a really busy intersection quite often. We do often see tracks here of both lion and leopard, and this is where the Nkuhumas went out yesterday morning. So far, just lion tracks from yesterday. Thank you. lots of elephants. Oh, there we go. Ha-ha! Not Karuda tracks. Looks like a nice big male leopard track. Quite difficult to see with all the elephants around. So we're going to try to figure out what's going on here. While we do that, let's go see what Sam's up to.
So we've come back to the hyena den. As we came to the hyena den, there was something in one of the hyenas' mouth that then ran away with it down Aubrey's Road. And then I just sat at the den for about 2 minutes to see potentially if something's coming back. And I think now what we're going to do is we're going to bumble back down Aubrey's Road just to see if there's any activity going on there. Because the three hyenas that we saw just on Sandy Patch that ran into the thicket ran in this direction. So the best chance we have of seeing those hyenas again is possibly running through here somewhere. And we did find fresh leopard tracks down by Sandy Patch as well. So we might go and work that area as well. Smile would like to know, was there some commotion with the hyena? Yes, they were just playing on the big open area at Sandy Patch. Playing in the sense they were just running from tree to tree. We only had about 10 seconds with them. There's three large ones, it wasn't the youngsters. And they were just running around there, and then they ran into this thicket. So we went round and came and had a look for them. So they could be anywhere. And we did see a number of birds just going crazy at them. So we might be able to hear that sound again, which will bring us closer to those hyenas. We're just looking in every direction now. So Siberia Zumi would like to know, how often do hyenas come into our campsite and fiddle with our rubbish? Well, so Siberia Zumi, it happens every now and then. Normally when we go to sleep at night time, someone has to bring the bin inside. And sometimes we forget. And next thing we know, the bin is everywhere. And there's food everywhere. And there's plastic everywhere. And it just becomes quite a nightmare to clean. So that happens sometimes, maybe once every 2 weeks. What do you think, Ben? Somewhere around there, eh? Mainly on the weekends, yeah. So it's not very nice when that happens, but they are scavengers, opportunistic hunters and scavengers, so they'll look for anything. At the moment, they're just trying to... We definitely caught wind of them, so I could smell them quite significantly a little bit earlier. And they definitely had something in their mouth as they ran away. Who knows where they ran away to, that's the question. No tracks crossing that I've seen so far. We'll go back towards Sandy Patch because they came from the Buitilla access down towards this area. So potentially there could be a kill down in that area that they were feeding on or something like that a little bit earlier. So if we go in that direction, potentially we might find something more than just hyenas. So hyenas just give us the indication that there has been some activity in the night. It's all about locating that activity. Maybe there's a leopard up a tree, a buffalo that's been killed by some lions. We know that the Mungen pride, as I said, was seen a little bit earlier. Not earlier this morning, but yesterday. They were at Chikana Dam, which is just further north into Buffelshoek. Actually, it's on the other perimeter, the other boundary line of Buffelshoek. So, but they could have crossed overnight, so we don't know. That's why I want to go and work that area. But it's starting to open up a little bit better now. We can see if we can see hyenas running through these thickets. Doesn't seem to be anything this morning. Yes. The tracks, the signs of elephants are around, so we definitely might be able to find some elephants this morning. As you can see, there's quite a bit of tracks in the dung in the road. So nothing through there. We're about to come back onto Mutila Access Road. There's going to be a remarkable sunrise this morning. You can already see some beautiful pink in the sky. Maybe if the elephants just see that through that little bit of
It's not an easy shot. It's actually a plant right in the way there. Tree. But can you see that wonderful bit of... How incredible is that pink? It's always great to start our morning off with a fantastic sunrise. What time of day is it there for you, wherever you are in the world? I love the early mornings. Nice, beautiful clouds, nice sunrise. Always gets me quite excited for the day. I think in America it must be around, what, like 12 or 2 to 3 in the morning. It's quite early. I just have a thing where I cannot sleep. I cannot go to bed after 12. I can only sleep at 12, but like I have a body clock where I must be sleeping by 12. So I appreciate that all of you guys are still with us. Okay, let's go off to Brent and get an update from him and see how he's doing. We're going to drive this road to see if there's any more activity. We'll let you know.
So these male leopard tracks are really fresh. So sometime after midnight would be my guess. And they're heading straight towards Biffle's Hook Dam. We're following up. And it could be two different leopards here. It's possible it is Tingana. He does like to walk this route. But it is also possible that it could be Gajima. This is the area where we see both of them. Let's double check that the tracks are still there while I was talking to you. So fingers crossed that the leopard is just having a relax at the dam. So Kyle's wondering whether we're going to do an impossible quiz today. Kyle, I think we might just have to, but maybe a little later. For the moment, I'm going to concentrate on following these leopard tracks. So while we do that, let's jump back on with Sam. And hopefully when we come back, we'll have a cat of the spotted variety to show you.
So this is exactly where we saw the hyenas coming through this morning. They ran straight through here. And if you go through here, we were at the den sites that were then inactive. But they ran down this road, which is Vuyatela Access Road. And so we're just going to drive down here just in case there might be something here, some activity. I'm gonna see if I can see them running or playing around here. So Brent is off tracking fresh leopard, male leopard tracks. So hopefully Brent will come out with a nice looking male leopard this morning. Hopefully he does. We'll see if we can locate on some lines ourselves. So I never really come this far to this area. I normally always go towards down that road towards Sydney's Dam. So there could be actually something happening at Sydney's Dam. So we'll drive through here around to Sydney's Dam just to check for any evidence that might be happening this morning. Lucy from South Bend, Indiana said it's currently 12:15. That is quite early or late or that's very in the morning, 12:15 in the morning. Yeah, so that's very, very early. Hopefully Lucy, we can give you some action that keeps you up at South 3, because we still got another 3 hours of drive, Lucy. And all the rest of you viewers that are watching live from America. Of course, different time zones in America, huge continent. There doesn't seem to be much happening around here. So this is a common pathway for one of our male leopards that likes to walk through here. Brent came and taught me that. You can often find tracks if we look left or right here. No tracks here. So it's quite a chilly morning. Sandy from Canada would like to know, if we found wild dog or leopard, can we drive off-road? Yes, Sandy, we can drive off-road. It's only for the cheapest. There's an amazing sunrise coming. I'm going to get you a nice shot of it. And it's only for the buffalo and the elephant. There we go. Look how awesome that is. So it's 12:15 where you are. It's very, very dark. But as you can see, it's very early for us. Just after 6. So you'll get your sunrise soon. You know, I think I've only ever stayed up for the sunrise once. So you've got some lion tracks? Yeah. Are they looking quite fresh?
Yep, right here, more lion mail.
Okay, cool. I'm just going to reverse.
Yeah, we're just right here, journey through.
Are they going up there?
Up there. No, they're walking all around.
Yeah, we've got some fresh lion tracks.
They're walking around.
And hyenas as well.
So this is interesting because this is where we saw the hyenas come from. We've got some very relaxed looking antelope that are there. So that's always a good indication to see that. It's an impala. Let's carry on down this direction and see if there's any other unsettled looking antelope around here. From after viewing and seeing some hyena and lions. John from Arkansas would like to see an aardvark track. John, we're going to do our best. As soon as it brightens up our day,
the day brightens up rather,
we'll see if we can find an aardvark track. They look very like three long lines in the ground. Very distinctive to see an aardvark track. So as soon as I see one, I'll show it to you. So let's just see if the... So now we're on our cut line. Let's just see if there's any tracks coming in here. Again, were the tracks heading this way?
Yes.
So they've probably crossed there. The line tracks have probably crossed. Anna Marie would like to know if we've seen Kijima yet. No, I'm going to reverse quickly and go back towards the Sydney's Dam before I work this area, just because that's where I was told that the Mungian pride might be lying up this morning. I haven't seen Kijima since I was with Liam last time. I haven't, so that's also where we're going now, is where we might find Kijima. We'll drive that cut line for a bit to see if there's any signs of the wonderful looking Kijima. Yesterday we were with a beautiful female leopard. Wow, she was very, very cool to see her on the very western edges of Arethusa. So that was cool to see that. Thank you, James Richard. Kaleyeshe was a very, very beautiful leopard to see. I was very, very excited to see her. It was, we just got notes from one of the guys as we drove into Arethusa, one of the guys that works at Arethusa. And we found out that we should go in that direction, we might find her. And lucky enough, myself and Dave went exploring and we found that wonderful leopard. And that's just the way it works. I mean, you can track and work as hard as you like, but sometimes it's all about also asking and communicating with other guides and people that actually work on the reserve. So we've got some more tracks over there.
They're heading that way, dude.
Yeah. Yes.
Brent is at Bithlethorp Dam. He's still following up on the tracks there.
So you've got those lion tracks now heading there. We're just going to go check Sydney's Dam quickly, because it's not far away from here. Have a look at that sunrise in the distance. What a magnificent thing to look at from this direction.
They come down here. Yeah.
And they're going up there.
Yeah, quite a lot. My more than one.
There's very few tracks there.
Right.
So it's more than likely, let's just quickly look there and then come back down and drive that cut line. Just want to check some of these. Just for something else. I know that the lines look like they've moved out of here.
Looks like they've gone back too.
All right. So let's just go around here and see if there's anything in the distance here. Lots of elephant tracks as well. It's more than likely if those tracks are heading that direction that they've gone towards other property. Mary Ellen says that she stays up past midnight because she loves being out on safari with us. That's great. Very glad that that's really, really cool. Always makes it that much more exciting to come out knowing that there's a whole bunch of people just through the back of this lens. Not just Vian behind me, it's a whole bunch of other people. Okay, so we're at Sydney's. Let's just have a look down at Sydney's and see if there's anything down there. Because it could be that some of the lions maybe headed off and some stayed here. So it's why it's worthwhile just checking. There's Sydney's. So it seems to be very empty at the moment. Might be a hippo in the middle of the pool there. Just gonna go up and then come back around because Brent is now at the top there, which is Buffalo. So he'll be working that area. Kojima is also in this area. But that could be very well that Brent is tracking Kojima. Kojima's property kind of Kojima's territory from what I understand is actually the border, this cut line here. You don't often see him in this area itself. So now that we know that Brent's up there, we can go back down here, but it's worth just having a look. That's beautiful though. So there's nothing there. I'm just checking on the dam wall just to see. It's worth also getting my binoculars out and making sure. Pinchy Winer's Hat would like to know how long I've been a tracker for. Let me just look up there. So there's nothing that is lying up against the watering hole there. Made sure of that, so that's done. Now we can go search other places. I'd like to know how long I've been a tracker for. Well, you know, the root word of the tracker is actually someone who understands and has lived in this area for a long time, that understands not only the footprints, but the way in which an animal moves at night time and its different places where it will scent the mark. So I've only started learning, you know, that kind of the science behind tracking. Science, you know, tracking is not just a science, but it's also an intuition, and it's a sensory experience. So yeah, that's why I love the art of tracking so much, because it forces you to bring more elements into doing something where you can't just rely on your rational mind to be like, I think the lions are going to be there. You have to use a little bit of intuition. You have to use a little bit of your senses in terms of smelling and listening to all the different things that are out there. So I only started that when I was 22, when I started learning tracking and all that sort of stuff. And then, so I'm 25 now, turning 26 tomorrow. And yeah, so I've still got lots to learn. I didn't grow up in this environment, so I've got so much to learn. So let's follow up on these lion tracks and see where they head off. Awesome, so Brent is with something quite large. Let's go to him. We're gonna see where these lion tracks go.
So we have found a large beast, but unfortunately these large beasts have been making our leopard tracking a little bit difficult. So I went for a walk and I found where, I'm pretty sure it's Tingana just from the size of the tracks, where he came down towards the water, but then his tracks got obliterated by some of this guy's friends. And then when I walked further, I walked into this guy. And when I walked off to the other side, I walked into another one. So a couple of big Eddie Bulls around. This guy's probably late 20s. Nice big boy. You can just see the amount of elephant dung that's building up around the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. It's going to be a really, really busy area as we move further into the dry season. Oh, thirsty boy. Now, it's difficult to believe that the water levels at about this time last year were sitting about there. So he would have been sort of stomach deep in the water. You can see little blacksmith lapwings off to the left of his head. Well, we continue on our search for leopard. Sam has got another cat.
Welcome back, everyone. So we've just found the lion. I got out my vehicle to follow tracks that were moving into Simambili here, so we can't actually drive towards those lions at the moment. It just seems to be one female in the distance there. This could very well be the Mungen pride. So that's very, very exciting. What happened was I got down to follow tracks to see if they had crossed over. And as I went down, it got up and VM said, look, there's a lion in the distance there. And we've just found these lions. So let's sit with them for a bit. Potentially they'll move back onto our property. The morning sun is beginning to rise on them there, and I think that's the Mungen pride. The breakaway Mungen pride. We know that the Salala breakaways have gone back maybe towards Londolozi through Arethusa. So this is very exciting to see that we are here with a female. What is she doing? She looks like she's just standing there on her own. I can't see any other females that are with her at the moment. I'm just going to get my binoculars out and see. There she goes. How lucky we were to see that. Just going to look to see if there's anything else there. Okay, so we can't drive anywhere there, so that's Simambili behind us. All we can do is hope that maybe they'll cross back over, but if their tracks are heading in that direction, the chances are that they'll carry on in that direction. They wouldn't really cross back, but you never know. They could start playing or hear the sound of some animal behind us. That was very exciting. Well done, Vim. It's always exciting going out in the morning and seeing what we can find. So if we look behind us, we've also got the sun that's now emerged right here. So it's a beautiful sunrise now in the distance there. Fantastic. That pink has started to go away and that bright sun has now emerged, which will bring us some warmth for the morning. So we've already started with three hyenas running around and some lions, which is exciting. So potentially, if we sit in this position for a bit longer, which I think we should, just to see if there's any of the alarm calls of the birds that are going off over there, because then maybe they'll cross over here. But potentially those three hyenas that we saw a bit earlier that were running from this direction will come back over this cut line. And there probably is maybe a kill here. I mean, there could very well be a kill here. Because that's where the hyenas maybe were trying to get.
done, VM. Well done, VM. I'm just going to say on the radio quickly that we've spotted some. Brent's just updated people around my lines. Yeah, I can see a line in the distance. Sorry about my hat's in the way there. So I was just trying to see if I could see something. I think you can just see her. No, that's just... There we go. You can just see her moving. Awesome. That line is still very, very present and shot there. You can see it through the thicket there. I think that we should just sit with it for two more minutes just to see if it's going to come back in this direction. Let's just see what this line wants to do.
Left.
As soon as that line moves out of shot, we'll go to Brent, and Brent is with a large elephant, so it looks like it's gone out of shot. We're not going to go anywhere. We'll let you know if it comes back towards us or somewhere down the road. At the moment, let's go and see how Brent's doing with a nice big animal.
So guys, just enjoy this elephant. I'm just on the Game Drive channel at the moment. Standing by, F. Same big bull having a drink. We have found the leopard tracks again. They've come out on the other side of the elephant tracks and they've headed north. Standing by, FM. Okay, copy. Thanks, F. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that Ingwe we saw coming Kaya last night was Karula. She was due to the vehicle. Sorry, I was just getting updates about what was seen, where was seen. There we go. And this Ellie Ball's finished with his morning drink. Shake his head at us now. Well, he thought about it at least. I do love it when they open their ears and look down their trunks towards you. So he's trying to look impressive. That's what he's doing there. He's opening his ears. He's trying to remind us that he is a beautifully large beast. We shouldn't try to tangle with him. So peaceful. A very warm welcome to Natasha in Ontario. Natasha said she watched the return of Brent yesterday on Sunset Safari and we were on Border Patrol. What is Border Patrolling? Well, Border Patrol is a little thing VM and I came up with a while ago. It's where we drive the perimeter of our traverse area. Unfortunately, we didn't quite get through the rest of our perimeter yesterday. We got sidetracked by those two male cheetah that were hoping that we're going to move back towards Cheetah Plains. So basically what we do, and it always depends on what we see, is that we drive all the boundaries, all the perimeter boundaries of our traverse area to see what's coming in or out. We've only ever managed to complete a border patrol once, because normally we find such fascinating things on the Border Patrol that we get sidetracked. Right, speaking about being sidetracked, we're in the hunt for leopard, and this Ellie has sidetracked us, so we're gonna head off to make sure those leopard tracks don't head into the north, but they were heading up the little access road. Mr. wants to come say hello. It's always funny, I love that about elephants. So they walk up to you to come give you a good chase. As soon as you stop the car, they sort of say, oh, maybe not. And most things are supposed to run away from me because I'm so big. There we go. You can see by his body language, we can just watch that tail wagging in the back there. And he's not at all aggressive, more just curious. Hey, big boy. So John's wondering how much water can an elephant drink in a day? John, it can drink about 100 litres, which I think, if my conversion is correct, it's about 20 gallons. Okay, mister, you continue being elephant. We're going to go look for this male leopard. So the last track of that male leopard I saw was around here. Just check very carefully. Of course, around a waterhole like this, especially because it's so dry, there's so much toing and froing of big beasts that sometimes the tracks can get walked on, which does make it a little bit more challenging to follow. Not seeing any tracks now. I'm just trying to go to some softer soil up ahead. If I don't get any tracks there, then I'll have to jump out and have a closer look on foot. But while we do that, let's go see what Sam's up to.
So we've got another lion track that's heading off onto Simambili. So there's been quite a bit of action this morning. There it goes. It's coming round and down. Lots of hyena tracks that are here as well. So, we were just sitting with those pride of lions, and obviously they're not on our property, so they've either headed in a southerly direction in that way, or they've gone west. So we're not sure what they would have done, but we can't go there either way. So we thought we would just drive along the perimeter of the seeing them, just in case they might have popped out somewhere where we just don't know at the moment. But what we're going to do is that we've just let people know that there is some lions that have been seen in that area, and potentially they may, I mean, it's starting to get bright, and they might just lie up somewhere in Simambile, but they might just head over to Arethusa a bit later, and then we can view them. So I'll pay attention to the radio and listen out to see if that pride moves in that direction. But what an exciting morning. Liam and I are very excited to have started the lions. Kyle is saying that lioness that was far away doesn't look very familiar. Hello, Mr. Wildebeest. Why is that wildebeest just suddenly jumping out? We've seen a waterbuck and a wildebeest just come out of the thickets here. Doesn't look that nervous, but I think it's a waterbuck. Can't see from here. Yes, it is. So let's just move slowly and look in this direction. Maybe there is something. I doubt it though, because we probably would have heard some alarm calls. But yeah, Carl, I don't know if I've seen that lion before, but I used to stay at Londolozi when I did my training, and I learnt about the Mungen pride. And I looked, they were on our eastern boundary, or our western boundary when I was at Londolozi, and I got to know them, and I think they are the breakaway Mungens. Which is the young sub adults that have come up into this area. So that could very well be the Mungen pride out of there. So if someone's just come online, what happened this morning, we saw hyenas running off into the distance there. We went to go check the den to see if anything had happened. So this looks like there's a very relaxed impala there. So it doesn't look like there's anything that's here. It's worth having a look. We saw some unrelaxed, we saw some hyenas running around, and we went down to Sydney's dam to see if there was anything. We found tracks, then we followed those tracks down to this cut line, and then I got out the car to follow the tracks, and they were going off into Simambile, and as I walked towards the cut line, I was looking at the track, and VM saw one of the lionesses jump, pop its head up out of the thicket there, and then that's how we saw the lioness. So that's a very exciting morning. Let's see what else we can find this morning. Brandon in Ohio just asked a very good question around what kind of conflict might exist now that there's quite a few different brides of lion that are in the area. We have noticed that there has been a few, from the Nkuhumas to the Mangen to the breakaway Solalas, and how might that change the dynamic with the Birmingham Boys, which are the coalition? So specifically looking at the female lionesses between the different brides, of course there's going to be that kind of territory. Each pride likes to have their own territory within their area, and if other prides are starting to come into the area, that's going to start creating some unease. But for the Birmingham Boys, that's better for them. The more prides of lion they have in their territory, the more chance they have raising cubs of their own. So they'll try and dominate all the different prides that they can get, they can come across while they can. The tension between the prides will be significant and large, but they will hold. They will create their territories and hold them. It's not often you get to see two lion prides meeting each other, and I must say I haven't seen that before. Some tracks here of a look like a hippo track that was crossing through here. So, what else might we find this morning? So Brent is off the vehicle going and following up on potentially those male leopard tracks that he found this morning. I think what we'll do is we're going to just head down towards Arethusa and potentially go and have a look and see if we can find something on those open areas of the estuary. You can see that this road is quite bumpy as we're shaking around here. I don't want to go too quickly. What would be fascinating is we actually got the opportunity to see two prides meeting each other. Mandy would like to know if we have foxes here. We don't have foxes here. I mean, we might have the bat-eared fox that gets seen in these areas of the Kruger National Park. But to be honest, I've only ever seen the Cape Fox, which is in Cape Town. Close to the Cedarburg Mountains. Mainly we get jackals here. So there's the bat-eared fox and then there's the Cape Fox, but I'm not sure on what kind of territory the bat-eared fox holds. I've never seen one in the Saba Sands. I've only ever seen the black-backed jackal and the side-striped jackal. Josephine from New York says that she's a long-time viewer and that she wants to know what made me become a presenter. Well, Josephine, it never happened so that I haven't grown up wanting to be a presenter. It was never something I wanted to be. It just so happened that opportunity came. And, what happened was, 3 months ago, I was actually going to go work in a city to try and build kind of systems thinking and biomimicry into social innovation in Cape Town. And now a month later I get a job in the bush. So it wasn't something that I planned. But my stepmother, Michaela, is a presenter for spring watch and autumn watch, and she's been a big influence on my life. Of course, you know, just seeing what she does and how she does that. And you know, I've always wanted to decentralize and share knowledge. And I think that's really, really important. I mean, for example, I studied in England, the ecological design, and I had to pay quite a lot of money to study there. And I think being a presenter and sharing knowledge around the things that I'm passionate about, and you know, in terms of bringing young people into the experience of wilderness, is a very, very important part of conservation. In my mind, I think that we need to build compassion within the youth towards the natural world if we want to have conservation in the first place. I think conservation comes with the art of knowing. So as soon as we bring ourselves into a greater experience of the natural world, the more we will want to protect it. So that's one of the main reasons why I wanted to come, and I wanted to be able to decentralize what I know, which is only so much, and I also just wanted to have deep experiences with the natural world. And the thought of being able to bring many other people into that experience just got me quite excited. So that's the answer to why I wanted to be a presenter, to be able to share and go on deep experiences with people from around the world. Isn't that exciting? Who wouldn't want to do that? Greg has just asked, with the dead trees, and I think the dead leaves, is there anything that will eat those dead leaves, and how might they be used? Well, of course, everything out there in the natural world will be used, from dung that's defecated from lions to elephants, and even the leaves that fall off the trees. Not only will those leaves that fall off the trees become part of the nutrient cycle of the tree itself, but also will become cover for different rabbit species and other species that like to be under the soil. There's an impala here. He's moving off into that area there. Let's go off onto the impala and see if we can find any tracks of potentially shadow. So I just heard the sound of an elephant. There goes some wildebeest in the distance there. Let's go. So, VM's nickname is Vildy, and now we're looking at some wildebeest. Awesome. So, as I was saying, with plant matter, dead decaying matter, we'll often find, you know, some animals might browse on some of the dead leaves on the ground, but mostly it'll turn into organic matter that will then become nutrition for both the trees and habitat for other animals that will need some cover. It's amazing that when leaves fall on the ground, they become nutrients for many, 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 many other organisms. Javier Izumi has a question for you there, Vian. Did you get it? So
I'll say it again.
So the question that was asked, Vian, to be a photographer and a filmer out here in the bush,
are we looking at these wildebeest?
Do you need any specific kind of license to be a filmer and a photographer out here?
No, just pick up a camera and get out here. Yeah?
That's the greatest answer. So from Vildy himself, he says, pick up a camera and get out here. So that's great advice. If any of you guys would like to be a filmer, a photographer out here in the bush, please pick up a camera and start shooting. Just practice
your ISOs, practice your different, you know.
You can sit outside your garden. I don't know if Vildy will agree with me. My dad's a filmer and a photographer as well, and he always used to say to me, pick up a camera, and just, you know, if you want to be, you know, wanting to shoot, wow, there's a lot of wildebeest here, let's have a look at them. If you want to start, just go out into your garden,
and start filming some birds, and then you can get the idea of what it's like to film wilderness. So go and have some fun in your garden. See what birds you might be able to catch, and birds are sometimes the hardest. So there the wildebeest again. So the VM has been out in the bush for quite some time. He doesn't actually go many other places than the bush. On his leave cycle, we went out to the Kruger National Park just to drive around for a few days in this nice big car or vehicle that has like a caravan on it. And so he has loads of experience, not only working with cameras in sports filming, I think it was, have you?
But
also where he goes off into the bush and practices his films. So what's the name of that film you just made, Robbie?
The Kalahari.
Yeah.
Theatrics of the Kalahari.
Theatrics of the Kalahari. So I'll share VM's video after drive so that you can see it. I'm sure he shared it on his wall already. But that's really cool to be talking about Vildi and all Vildi's experience in front of some wildebeest. And there really is quite a few out here this morning. There really is. So there's some youngsters around here. And the biggest herds that I've seen are on Cheetah Plains. So it's nice to come onto this area and see that there are quite a few wildebeest here. There's a little bit of interaction there between one of the youngsters and the other wildebeest. There's two youngsters there. You can tell there's two youngsters just by the much shorter looking horns that stick out like that there. And they're obviously quite a bit smaller than the females and the males here. But there'd be one big dominant male here, and I think I can see him. There's a wildebeest to the right there. He's incredibly good looking wildebeest there. Look at the size of him. That could be our dominant male here, and so he will protect this land, protect the grazing rights to this area, as well as access to any water in this place. He'll show dominance by rolling himself in dirt and putting his forehead in the dirt and rubbing it, and that's the way in which he will mark his territory and show other males that this is his place. And you can see he's done a great job because he has got quite a large herd behind him here. Fascinating to sit here. As you can see, wildebeest like to eat those short grasses. So they'll be in these open areas grazing on the shorter grasses. What was also interesting, we were on. Ooh, what's happening there? That's the big male that we were looking at. There seems to be a bit of. He doesn't look happy. You can see that there was a little bit of dominance display there. Let's go and have a look and see what's happening. What's interesting is, I think that could have been a young male. That was a young male wildebeest that was with that male there. And he just wanted to show. So maybe these herds have... Oh, there's something going on. I just want to get down there. That was fascinating to see that. Wildebeest really got a good visual of that as it happened. Well done, Gordon. There's one of them. They've just gone into this area. I don't know if that's the one that ran in there with them. I think it could be. There's another one that ran off, and I've just looked into the distance, and I can see him kicking about. That was so cool to see that. I think things have cooled down a little bit. Maybe potentially if we just do a loop around here and come back, we might be able to find those two having a little bit of an interaction. I can't see the wildebeest anywhere. just go back onto that open area. Potentially there might be a little bit more conflict there. You can see some dust through the distance there that was kicked up. You can see it as it goes through the sun there. It doesn't look like there's a wildebeest in there anymore. Let's go back onto the open area and just see what the kind of behavior is looking like over here. They're right by us now. That's a beautiful scene there of all the open areas. Let's sit here for a minute or two just to see what the feeling is within this herd. Lucy, from South Bend, Louisiana, is asking, do the female wildebeest have much thinner horns than that of the male? Yes, they most certainly do. So have a look at the horns here. I think this could be a female here. The way in which you tell the difference between the female and the male is not only by looking at the horns, but by seeing that there's actually a little bit of a brown patch in between the horns there. You can tell you quite clearly that there's a difference. Let's see if we can find that male and we can have a look at his horns. His horns are a lot bigger. Look at them, all grazing. There's short grasses here. There's that bird called the brown crown chagra that I can hear. So I know that we want to get our bird lists up, so I'll see if I can find that while we look at these grazing wildebeest. Keepers, it's been an exciting morning. Wildebeest fighting, lion prides, hyenas running. It's a great shot. If you want to get a screenshot of grazing wildebeest, this is the one you should get because they're quite close to our vehicle. And there's a nice background of sunlit grass. It looks really, really, really nice. So I've been sitting down in the mornings with Rebecca sometimes to learn about the different animals that we have here. And I was reading about the wildebeest and how the wildebeest has three social units out here. You get the bachelor herds. Sorry about my hat there. The bachelor herds, you get the large groups of these, what we can see here, which is females, calves, and a dominant male, and then you also get single solitary males. So that's the three different ways in which you'll view wildebeest out here. So the solitary male will stay in his territory, look after where the grasses are, and protect that area from other male wildebeest that would like to take over. And then that second unit again is what we are seeing here, where the youngsters are brought with the females into that dominant male's territory. And then finally, you get some young wildebeest, which are males. It's called a bachelor herd, which you'll sometimes see as they grow together and form some sort of dominance between them and grow. Much like you see bachelor herds of impala. Something that I'd be fascinated to find is, when would a bachelor leave a bachelor herd? That's something that I can find out today and share with you at the next sighting of the wildebeest. Here we can see a young one. I think they have such an interesting morphology and design, wildebeest. Really are very, very pretty looking animals in terms of their structure. You see how their neck really bends down there to get to those short grasses. So over millions of years or years of evolution, their bodies have adapted to running far distances and migrating, and also being able to hunch down to get to those shorter grasses. Very, very cool to spend time with them.
Sally from Oregon is saying they are like four-footed lawnmowers. Oh, they very much are like that. I agree with you, Sally. It's so nice to actually spend some time with a really, really big group of them on Juma. As you know, Juma is quite thick in vegetation, so it's not such a perfect habitat for them. And potentially, I know that I haven't forgotten Aaron wanting to see a zebra track. We haven't seen a zebra for a while. Don't worry, as soon as I see a zebra, we're going to see if we can find a track. And as well, there was another track that wanted to be seen this morning, an aardvark track. That's it. So I haven't forgotten. We'll see if we can find it. In the meanwhile, let's go and see how Brent is doing, get an update. We're going to head off and see if we can find some tracks.
So unfortunately, that male leopard decided to leave us and go to Buffalo's Hook. So could be Gajima, could be Tingana. Just checking here quickly. And where we saw Karula wasn't too far from where we are now last night. I'm just double checking. She hasn't snuck back through here. But alas, no luck just yet. Starting to warm up now. Sun is out. Snoop's wondering if any of us are heading towards Cheetah Plains. That I am, Snoop. I was just having a quick look for leopard on Juma first, before making the long trip down to the east. But we are getting towards the Gowrie Main, which is the road that takes us to Cheetah Plains. And I was hoping to find Karula first, but it looks like she might be giving us the slip. She might still be in Torchwood. There is another spot she sometimes likes to walk through, which is coming up here. Sorry guys, just on the radio for a second. Go ahead, Sam. Sam, they're crossed into Buffalo's Hook. I'm going to head down towards Cheetah Plains. If you want to check, maybe check from Gowrie Cutline back towards Buffalo's Hook Dam in case he came back out onto the boundary. Copy, thanks. There's always a possibility that male leopard could have popped back up further to the west, but we made the decision to go look for the cheetah down on Cheetah Plains, so we weren't going to carry on heading west when we've got a long way east to go. So William in Oregon is wondering who maintains all these roads. So William, the roads like we're on at the moment will be maintained by the individual reserves. They are what we call two tracks. They don't actually need too much maintenance. Every now and then you'll see these bumps. These are called miter drains. It's to stop runoff and disappearing of the road, so to take the water off the road during the wet season. But other than that, only when an elephant pushes a tree onto the road or whatnot is there maintenance needed. But the big access roads like Triple M and Gowrie Main are maintained by the Sabi Sands. But the rest of all the little internal roads are all maintained by the individual properties. As I said, not too much maintenance needed. No, hyena, unfortunately. Thank you. And this is, we're coming right to the end of our eastern boundary. Thought I heard something there. More than likely just a male impala being silly, but always worth double checking. Yeah, male impala. So Siberia is wondering if there's any chance of seeing a Cory busted on cheetah plains. There most definitely is. I heard they have seen them in a buffalo's hook before on the open areas. But of course there's a chance, there's always a chance, and if we are going to see them, it will be on cheetah plains for us. That, well, they do sometimes occur in little open areas like this, but the bigger the open area, generally the better for Cory busted. And now we're on the main road down to Cheetah Plains. And I'll show you exactly where we saw Karula last night. This is Torchwood to my left and Chitwa to my right. Double checking, you never know if that Birmingham boy might have walked up here. I dropped a branch on the road to show Ephraim, who was coming down this road after me, where Karula crossed, so he could look for her last night. He didn't have any luck afterwards though. She crossed right here. This is exactly where she crossed along this big animal path, big elephant path, and she carried on into Torchwood. But we're going to keep heading towards Cheetah Plains. And while we do that, why don't you guys jump back on Sam and see what he's up to?
Brent is back off towards Cheetah Plains to see what he might be able to find there this morning, as well as to see last tracks of Karula where she crossed over last night. We just left those wildebeest that they have such a spectacular sighting of male dominance. We could quite see that there. Interesting to see that. And now we're just going to be heading around down here towards Gowrie Main, where Brent was not so long ago, but we'll cut back onto Treehouse Dam and just see if something's going on at Treehouse Dam, see if there's any tracks of any male or female leopards in that area. Potentially Shadow could be in the area. That's why I'm quite keen to have a look around Philemon's Dip in that area just to the south of us here. I haven't seen Shadow before. I know Shadow's got two cubs as well. We might just be lucky enough to see that. Lucy from South Bend in the Louisiana. Sorry. I can't say him. Sometimes I can't speak well. Louisiana said that you wouldn't. Sorry, Indiana. Sorry, Lucy from South Bend, Indiana. You'd like to say thank you about those plastic recycled and then turning them into plants. Yes, Lucy, it's you know, I learned that from an organization called Green Pop in Cape Town, which they actually do a number of things in Zambia, because Zambia has lost a lot of their trees because of the charcoal burning. So Zambia has lost, I think it's only like 75% of its forests. So that organization that we're very close with in Cape Town, our organization, Sustainable Brothers and Sisters, and Green Pop try to develop ways. Mainly Green Pop has taught us that, how you can recycle things and put soil in them
And it's fascinating how we can bring that to schools, and you can start growing or showing people how they can grow their own food, as well as just growing plants. It's just such a nice practice to have, just growing a plant. And not only that, you know, seeing how you can use waste. I think that was the most powerful thing for me. Let's go down, we're gonna go down Shabam to Treehouse and then have a look around, back around. That was the most powerful thing for me, was to see that you can use waste and create it in another, for another purpose. So that's what upcycling is called. And I think our planet has a lot of waste on it, in terms of human waste and plastic and all that sort of stuff. And we need to start seeing how we could use waste in another way that is productive. Productive rather than unproductive, if that makes sense. So thanks, Lucy. Really, really appreciate it. I'm glad that you enjoyed that. And you know, it doesn't have to be, you can use upcycled waste for all sorts of things. Not just plants. You can start building systems where you can collect water on your roofs, or we just, you know, we all have creativity within us. We just have to unlock it and find it in a way that's passionate. For me, it's just about, I mean, my brother loves to farm and loves to do organic farming. And yeah. So that's Thomas. You'll meet Thomas one day, hopefully. Lots of tracks here. Looks like a buffalo breeding herd could have been walking through here. This is actually exactly where James and I were running. Myself, James and Dave, and I think it was Rebecca as well. We ran around here, came across a huge breeding herd of buffalo as we were running. And then that all just got up and ran away from us. And then we had to go deep into the thicket here and go round just to make sure that there were no old dagger boys that were trailing the herds. Those are the most dangerous ones that you have to be aware of. Not the breeding herd itself, but the ones, the outliers. Hold on, there's this. Looks like there's a drag mark here. I think it's just a buffalo, yeah. So that's quite interesting. We're talking about buffaloes. Let's have a look here. What we just saw on the ground. You can see the buffalo tracks in the ground there. And then you can see how he's dragged his foot in the ground. So that could very well be an old dagger boy that's walked across here. Awesome. Maybe we can find one. It could potentially be a Treehouse Dam. Treehouse Dam is not far away from here. Just down there, so potentially you might be able to see that. I've already seen a lion this morning. Hopefully you can see a leopard and an elephant. And even something small. I wouldn't mind seeing a nice big wasp and a warthog. There's a warthog there. Reverse. The warthogs can be quite shy. Can you see it at the moment? There it is.
I don't know. I see a little bit.
So, hold on. He's just into the thicket there. It looks like he's going to be walking off. I'm just going to move forward. And there he is, I can see him. They'll have visual of him now. There's a warthog. Good morning. How are you? Are you a lonely male? Could very well be. And there's a sound of a woodpecker close by. It's a fantastic sound to hear in the bush. So there the warthog is, and if we see that tail go up, maybe it's with some piglets, if it is a female warthog. And leopards do like to eat warthogs, especially the piglets. Can you hear that woodpecker that just went? So that is a warthog, and it's going to head off into the bushes in a few seconds. So there we go, there he goes. Let's head on to Shabam Road, then down to Treehouse Dam, and see if we can find ourselves a buffalo that might have just walked down into that area.
We've had quite an action-packed morning. We've
seen quite a lot of animals.
It's always exciting. But not only just animals, I mean, you never got to see those hyenas this morning. And we were very, very lucky. They just ran onto the screen, and it was interesting to see them playing and then running off. So this evening, I'll definitely go off to the hyena den and see if they are active. We'll actually drive that way a little bit later to go and see if we can find Kojima's tracks. And we'll go and have a look at that hyena den. Potentially, there will be something going on there. But there was something in that hyena's mouth when I saw it earlier this morning. So maybe there was a kill that was made by those lionesses that we saw this morning, that the hyena then managed to get something off and run back to the den, because they were all like, they were in a frenzy. It was fascinating behavior to see. A very, very thick frenzy. So there is also a family of warthogs that are in this area, where myself and Dave just sat next to them for a while, and we actually spent some time with those warthogs and the youngsters. Interesting social behavior. Oh, there's a black-headed oriole. Let's just see if we can see. Okay, it just flew off. That's so sad. I can see where it is. It'll be too far for this camera. It's in the thicket. It's a black-headed oriole. Let's just see if we can hear it. It's my favorite sound to hear out in the bush. Let's just give it 10 seconds. There's a bird in the branch there. There's a bird there. What bird is that? That looked like a chin spot badgers. Well, that was a very, very well done, Vian. I saw that bird jump on there. I'll show you the bird that I think we just saw. That will be a new bird to our bird list. 248. That's the bird I think we just saw. I don't know if you agree with me. I don't know if you all saw that. I know Vian seen that. The chin spot batters. So you would have seen, I saw those two white stripes at the back. That could potentially have been our chin spot batters. The way in which we'll tell if it was a chin spot batters is it has a sound that goes. Sounds like three blind mice. That could very well have been that. I'm going to put that on my bird book because I do actually think that it was a chin spot batters. I'm going to look in the bushes to see if I can see that black-headed oriole again. There's a bird here. Where is that? Is it going to go up into the tree? Yes, it is. I think it could be a woodpecker. There's a few birds over in this tree. Let's have a look at this tree slowly and see what it might be.
We've arrived on a Cheetah Plains, and we're just having a look at the western sections quickly. We normally shoot off down to the open areas, but there's some birds of prey around here. There's a couple of vultures. We just want to have a quick look. They could have been coming towards the Cheetah Plains pan for a drink. We'll have a look for tracks now, see if there's anything else about here. Try to get you a nice view of the white-backed vulture in the tree up ahead. How's that, Chandra? There we go. Good morning, vulture. But too cool for them to be out flying just yet. So They normally wait till it's quite a bit warmer before catching those thermals and flying around to see if they can find any carrion. But Vim and I did see these yesterday, and we did have a good look in the area. What I think happened is towards the end of the day yesterday, one vulture decided this was a good place to sleep, and another saw him, and they all got confused and thought there might be a kill here, but unfortunately, nothing. It's good to just keep quiet for a couple of seconds in the morning and listen. Keep on trucking on. This is not a road we drive too often on Cheetah Plains. We normally head straight off to the eastern areas, but I thought it might be worth. It's a nice crest through here. And that Birmingham male was heading in this general direction. Oh, excuse me. That's the same vulture. He just flew from where he was earlier to this other tree. White-backed vulture. See those very short feathers around the head and neck, and that's designed like that, so because they keep putting their heads in carcasses. So there's quite a lot of wear and tear on those feathers, as you can see. There's some gaps there. But he's going to have to wait a bit to find a meal until it gets a bit warmer, and he's going to be able to saw those thermals. So while we move through this seldom explored area, for us at least, of Cheetah Plains, Aqua would like me to share a story which I haven't actually told for a while, and it is about the time my guests thought I was eaten by a lion. Now, it happened quite a few years ago in the Kruger National Park in a private concession there at a place called Singita Nabombo. And my tracker, Glass Maramani, and myself were on the tracks of what was then called the Mountain Pride. Nat Geo came and did a feature on it and changed their name and called them the Mega Pride. There was about 40 or so lions in that pride at the time. And we went down off into a little river system called the Shinkelengan. We're following the tracks, and we spotted the lions at about 80 meters from us. We're probably no more than 60 meters from the car, but we were through a really thick area, so the guests couldn't see us. And they were very hungry, and we got some very unusual behavior from the two big dominant males in the pride. So the rule is, Noisy lion, safe lion. Quiet lion, dangerous lion. When you're on foot. So those two males got up and charged straight at us without making a noise, which is not a good thing. So my tracker was shouting at me, Dwula, man, Dwula, Dwula, shoot it, shoot it, shoot it. I, of course, did not want to shoot lions. And so I was like, no, throw rocks at them. And I was screaming in some choice language that we're not going to repeat today. And basically all the guests could hear. The lions eventually stopped their charge at about 5 meters. Oh, land a falcon. Oh, you're so quick. Oh, no, it's a good one, come on. Oh, the falcons, they're so fast. Is he gonna land? Is he gonna land? Come on, I know that's a new bird for a lot of people's lists. That's why I'm chasing it. He went through there. I'm hoping he landed in one of those dead trees. Oh, darn. It was, looked like a lanner. It could have also been a peregrine. I just saw it, but there are only two falcons of that size. Jandre, I think, thinks I saw a wild dog for a second there. Right? But, pity about that. He just flew over. Ah! Well, it's still another bird we get to look forward to. So, sorry, back to the story. At the lodge, we have earpieces like this, so the guests don't have to listen to all the radio chatter. So the guests, after the lions stopped, so the lions stopped their charge at about 5 meters. I was shouting and swearing at them, and so was my tracker. He was also throwing stones at them. I had my firearm loaded at this point. And so one of the ladies in the vehicle, all she could hear was us shouting and swearing at the top of our lungs. And the lions, who had now stopped their charge, growling and going and warning, charging us and us shouting. It took us about 20 minutes to get out of that situation. And in the meantime, the lady had grabbed hold of the radio and said, oh my God, my ranger has been eaten by a lion. And of course that caused a great pandemonium over the radio. And of course the radio was coming through an earpiece, so they were trying to now get hold of this lady, but had no way of getting hold of her. She hadn't put the earpiece in. So it ended up being quite a funny situation afterwards. Obviously at the time, there was quite a lot of stress and a lot of guys flying up to the northern sections of the Sangita concession, trying to find out if I actually had truly been eaten by a lion. But fortunately not. And as I walked back to the vehicle and got into the vehicle again, there was one British lady who said, Brent, I really didn't appreciate the language you used with those lions. I nearly fell over, but fortunately she was joking, so it wasn't too bad. But that was a very impressive lion charge from about 80 meters. And let's remember, a lion does about 21 meters per second, 80 meters. What's that? 20, 40, so 4 seconds, and they're on you. We don't often check this little river system, so I'm hoping we might find a leopard we don't know around yet. So Siberia is wondering, are vultures more common around populated areas in South Africa where they might feed on trash that's thrown away by humans? Not at all. Actually, they're even far more rare around populated areas. They are very, very... Sorry, let's turn that down. They are very, very specific in their diet, very Catholic in their diet of meat. So they don't eat trash, our vultures. I think a certain, or the one carrion eater, the marabou stork, can be found in eating trash quite heavily and in rubbish dumps all over Africa. And for example, the city of Kampala in Uganda has got thousands of them that line the rooftops, and they feed off all the human detritus that's left lying around. Nice to just check this area because we don't check it too often. X-Ranga says that sounds like a typical POM response. To my near-death experience with the lions, making a joke, and our English people called POMs in South Africa. They very much are called POMs, and other things, but we're not going to go into that. This is a very rude... Oh, sorry. I just heard something on the radio. Sorry, guys. F is there, visual from Gary Mann. So, F was found Tandy in Torchwood, and I was just asking if there's visual from that main access road, but there isn't. So, here we go. So, Tandy, very close to where we turn in to come into Cheetah Plains, is where Tandy has been found. I will keep listening to see if she does head this way. We have found female leopard tracks in this area that we think are Tandy's independent, unnamed cub. She's a little bit skittish around the vehicle, so apparently she's fine with one vehicle. And we're the only vehicle on Cheetah Plains at the moment. So we're gonna that's why I'm just checking this area a little bit. Bird party here. Quite a few different species. So there we go, Jandre is going to start down at the bottom with the fork-tailed drongo. Oh, here comes, oh, they didn't stop. There was a pair of orioles. Oh, come up, that little bird right in the center there.
There we go, that's a nice little interesting bird. It's a female red-headed weaver.
And then if we go to the left, there's an oriole. Here we go. Black-headed oriole. Oh, There we go. We're helping Sam out. He tried to show you one earlier, but it wasn't being as... We'll go straight on the road in front of us. Look, there we go. There's an oriole right out in the open. It's a juvenile black-headed oriole, that one. Oh, and next to the fork-tailed dronga. Really nice little bird party here. Be patient a little bit. We might get another couple of species out of it. There we go. Come out under it. Oh, there we go. Well done. Red-billed wood hoopoe. Just come out quickly. There's a bird. So, where's my hand? There. Come out a little bit to the right. To the right. And just hang on. I've lost sight of it now. Oh, that's gone.
Is it
hoopoe? We can go back to the hoopoe, yes. There's an African hoopoe, so we've had a green wood hoopoe and now an African hoopoe on the ground. I don't want to move too much. There's another couple of species that I think we can get out of here. And I mean, we've got oriole, red-headed weaver, green wood hoopoe, African hoopoe, fork-tailed drongo, black-headed oriole. That's not a bad little bird party so far. Six species without moving. And I think there's about 11 in total. I'm just keeping my eyes peeled and waiting for someone to fly into frame. We've got the oriole out in the open again. Yes, Jandre spotted it as well. Well done. Cool. Very beautiful birds. You can hear the green wood hoopoes start their cackling. An oriole out in the open again. You can hear the chortle of an oriole as well. Oh, we're gonna have to go. Can you get him through the gap there, Jandre? If you come out. It's a dead tree at the back. No, let's just try and move forward. Please don't fly, please don't fly. This should be species number 8, I think. It's a common scimitable.
Oh.
Get him now. We'll get him now.
Am I looking?
In this half dead. There he is, up the one beating a little bit lower. And there's the oriole's got a caterpillar. And just busy whacking that caterpillar. Okay, so the oriole's got a kill. Now, if we come out and down, you hear that oriole, beautiful call, down towards where their leaves. Okay, and then to the far right. There we go. A common scimitable. You can see how it's using that recurved beak, that scimitar-shaped beak, to get into the little holes and in between the bark of the tree to try to find any wood borer beetles or any other little creature. So how many species are we on now? Scimitable greenwood hoopoe. Oh, the scimitable, there's another scimitable right in front of us. Might be a bit clearer, Jandre. Right. There. And that, no, to the right. Oh, there he goes. He flew off. Okay. Oh, there we go. Ooh, what's that? I can't really see now.
Looks like a woodpecker or something.
No, it looks like a little. Where is that exactly? Oh, there. Okay, there we go. I would have said it was a little flycatcher, just judging by the shape. But I didn't get a good look. Let's see if we can find that one again. Quite a few orioles around. There's that black-headed oriole. Excuse me, sorry. So you can see there's an adult one with the red bill. And we did see a juvenile bit earlier. It had the darker bill and not the fully formed black head just yet. So we had fork-tailed jonga, African hoopoe, greenwood hoopoe, African scimitar bill, or common scimitar bill. Did I say black-headed oriole yet, Jandre?
Not on this list.
Black-headed oriole. We had fork-tailed jonga. I think we had about 7 or 8 species. I can't remember exactly now. But unfortunately, the bird party is moving off. Well, Anna-Marie says she loves the fork-tailed drongos and their bravery. And not even scared of those big raptors. And well, let's move on. Close eye, see if we can get any other species as we move out. Well, James Richard says he knows they're not related, but sorry, I'm just having a fiddle here quickly. That old world vultures use sites to find food, and new world vultures, I'm presuming like turkey vultures, use smell. Could it be environment based? James, I'm afraid I don't know enough about the new world vultures to be able to have a definite answer on that. So. It could definitely be environment-based, but I'm afraid... I think the only New World vulture I've ever seen was a turkey vulture on the highway outside of LA. So I can't really discuss too much. I'll have to look into that for you. Pinchy Whiner's Hat would like to know, was it 2 fork-tailed drongos that nearly had the fight to the death last year? Yes, it was them. It was fork-tailed drongos, and it was with James and myself on quarantine. I can't remember who the cameraman was. Was it you? No, it wasn't. I think it was Brian or Vim. So I don't know, as Jandre turned there, I think his knee knocked something. And I've lost my monitor. An African grey hornbill. Definitely a I love their call. It's very high pitched. Jandre, about to walk into the road. There's a diker. There we go. Oop, dip, across the road. Little grey diker. So I'm just listening to the game live. Just getting a quick update on what's going on. Nothing much so far. So I hear there's some great screenshots from the bird party. Well done. Hopefully, if anyone's just started their bird list, there were a few species to add there, and we'll keep checking for birds. And so we're gonna just try fix my monitor quickly. So while we do that, let's jump back with Sam and see what he's up to.
So the bush comes with many, many difficulties in terms of tech problems. You can imagine carrying a camera out to the bingos on the vehicle. There's quite a lot of maintenance to try and get this all to happen, from signal to presenter monitors, and it's all being worked on. We went back there, and we had the magician Connor, who knows how to fix anything with the back of our signals or anything like that. So that's why we have such an awesome team out here in the bush, that we are able to bring you a nice 6 hours a day of live safaris out in the middle of the bush. So we've just gone back to camp, sorted out that problem. As you can see, we're back, we're alive, and we're doing well. We're going back towards the hyena den that we were at this morning, just in case we could be active again. You know that the hyenas were there a little bit earlier. Well, they weren't there a bit earlier. They were running around sandy patch area earlier, and potentially they could have killed a young impala ram. So let's go back there, see if they're eating on anything. Just go and study, have a little case study of what's happening, and then we'll go drive and see if we can find tracks of Kojima. Lots of elephant tracks heading off in these different directions. Brent was able to show you the black-headed oriole, so I don't know if we managed to hear the bird call. It's got a very beautiful liquid call. This is my favorite bird call in the bush, 100%. And I'm glad that you managed to see it. So now let's pay attention. This is where we drove earlier when we were looking for the hyenas. It could very well be here somewhere. Just gonna look through this thicket. We're gonna go towards the den, but you never know, they could be running through here. Very, very thick here. So we're on our way to Trail's Band, but we had to come back. So that's actually just giving us an opportunity to come back to the hyena den, which I know a lot of people are quite excited to see more of the hyenas. So I know it's already, the sun is quite far up in the sky already. So this is generally, when the hyenas will be inactive. But because it's still quite cool, you could very well see some hyenas nibbling on
part of that kill that we saw earlier, or just maybe just playing around. Just kind of looking to the distance just in case one is running somewhere. There's a significant path here that I often find with the tracks. It's good to look at the animal cards. So that's another, we were talking about tracking this morning. When you're out here, have a look at some of the animal paths that have been created where, you know, where leopards and many buffaloes and that sort of stuff will walk and continue to make these paths more significant. And that's where you have a better chance of seeing something out here. So, as I said, everything has its own memory out here in the bush. You just want to try and access that memory of the area to learn more about the habits of the different animals out here. And you know, I've been here, what, five, six weeks, and I really feel like I'm growing with the land here, learning more about what this land is telling me. First, the den now. The southern den, which is the one we're going to go look at first, is the one that has been active recently. The northern den hasn't been as active. I heard she managed to see a bird party there as well. That's very cool. The brent and a raptor of some sorts. Sounded like quite a rare raptor that we also. On cheetah plants. The Lanath falcon. What a falcon to see. Well done, Brent. Okay, here we are. Some game. Our way up here. Just keeping quiet to see if I can hear any rustles. Yeah, I can't see much happening here. There's a steamboat that's running off in the distance there. I managed to see a flash of that steamboat as it jumped off into the distance. Here's the den. So we can show you that it would be inactive. Maybe it's not. It's in the parlor there. The female parlor was walking through the thicket there. Quite a dangerous, there's two of them, quite a dangerous place to be lurking if there are hunters anywhere. Look at the side, potentially on the other side. No hyenas here at the southern den. Let's go look at the northern den. Clouds are forming, quite an interesting look there. Right, let's head off, let's go see if we can find these guys. For some reason I've seen so many steenbok recently. Normally quite a secret dance about. Lots of times, we've seen quite a few of them. Especially on the cheetah plants. There's that one steenbok I was with the other day that I stood with for about 5 minutes and it looked like a statue. It didn't move a muscle. So you either see them in a position where they look like a stone, hence the name steenbok, steen stone. See them in a position where they are very still, or in a position where they are jolting through the bush, like we just saw now, which you imagine see that quick flash of it. J-Rad just said, have we ever thought of using drones to help spot animals. We have thought of that, and I think we do use them. Is that right?
Yeah, every now and then.
For the TV
specials. For the TV shows. That's when they use. I haven't been out when they've used the drone. That must be hugely exciting. It must make such a difference, being able to see something from above. But I think that it must scare the elephants quite a bit. So I'm just looking out into the northern den now. It's looking exceptionally inactive down there. So it doesn't look like we've got any hyenas this morning. We'll come back this afternoon. Potentially they will be there. I'm looking forward to seeing them again. I'm just hanging my eye. Fly just flew straight into my eye. Ah. That's the best day when a fly just flies straight into your eye. Just wants to say hello. Maybe there'll be a local down here. Feeling. Should we check on the radio? Stations, I've been down for about 15 minutes. Is there any updates for Via Tele? There we go. That's where we found the lions earlier. So they've crossed over into Simandini. Now off this way because Kijima looked like Brent was following tracks of a male leopard this morning, and it went off into Buffalo. There's every chance that it could have come back and done some scent marking. Myself and VM have actually spotted Kijima in this very location once before, so if we find some tracks, or we could even see Kijima on the road, could very well be lucky. Kijima. It's a bit of a chance we're taking there, because it's only one part of his territory. It's a smell like something has died in this area. Well, we carry on in this area and see what we can find. Let's go see how Brent's doing.
So we're now on the southern boundary of cheetah plains. Having a look for those two male cheetah, hoping that they have come to visit us. And we're just keeping a careful eye out for tracks at the moment and scanning all around us. So unfortunately that Birmingham boy we had last night has walked straight through cheetah plains and gone to the west. So he is unfortunately no longer within our traverse area. James Richard says, well, if we can't have wild dogs this morning, hoping we spot a jackal on cheetah plains. Well, as far as I think I've heard, Sam is jinxing the jackals. Every time he mentions the word jackal, we don't see any. Hopefully, we might have some luck. Hyena track. Well, Aaron from the land of the long white cloud says, thanks for the bird party. It taken his bird list up to 48. Well, Aaron, I think we should definitely try and get it to 50 today. And we will be keeping an eye out for any birds that might add it to your list. Okay, just over this rise is the first of the big open areas on Cheetah Plains. No tracks just yet. Just some buffalo tracks. So Dave is wondering if myrrh or the mirror incense tree, grows in South Africa. Thank you, John. It does not, Dave, as far as I'm aware. Here we go. Occasionally I have these bouts of about 20 sneezes in a row, and it's hopefully not one of those. If I'm driving down a main highway, I actually have to pull over to the side of the road, because it's quite dangerous closing your eyes when you're doing 120 kilometers an hour. Okay, so we're about to get to that first big open plain, and hopefully we'll be able to glass and find some. Oh, here we go. John Ray thinks this is quite funny. See if I can think my sneeze away. Let's just freewheel down the hill. Norman's patch. Looks like a good spot to stop and scan the plains. Time for binoculars. So, where the cheetah were lying yesterday was way over there on the other side. Of course, it's not very unlikely they're going to be lying in the exact same position again. looking for any shape that looks slightly out of place. What has Jean-André spotted? Nothing yet? Well, Brandon was wondering whether there are any updates on the cheetah. Brandon, I will let you know shortly. We are looking for them as we speak. Let's move a little bit further down the plains and see what we can spot something from a different vantage point. Well, Cornwallis and his ladies are still around. Go have a closer look at them shortly. I'm just going to keep a very close eye up this side there. Always go really slowly through these areas, not rush. Check every little half chance. If they were going to come north, likely to come north following the edge of this little river system. Just checking very carefully. This is a good spot to start looking for tracks. To our left is a Gnormless Gnorman and his lady friends. There they are. Gnormless doing well, keeping the ladies around for a bit. But we're going to keep checking along this southern boundary all the way through to Kruger, and while we do that, let's go see what Sam's up to.
So Brent is off on the cheetah plains to see if we can find a cheetah this morning. We are just moving, we are now on Boobo Road, and we're going towards the Juma Dam to see if there's anything there. I also just thought I'd show you, because we haven't seen any tracks of a zebra or a aardvark while we've been on drive. So I just thought I would show you quickly. I think it was James Hendry, and I've just forgotten who wanted to see the aardvark. Sorry, James Richard, not James Hendry. James Richard. So here, have a look here. Some tracks here. Here you can find the plains zebra over there. So that is very much the track of the zebra over there, James, if you're watching. And we'll see if we can find that in the practice on the ground. And then here is the John, here is the aardvark, which I'm just gonna show top left. And that is what the aardvark track looks like. Sometimes you can really see it when you go towards like kind of old muddy areas where an aardvark would have walked. Often their tracks are so distinguishable, you can really, really see them. So those are the tracks of the two beautiful looking animals that hopefully we can find as we drive along here. But also, I just thought what would be quite interesting is to maybe talk around any kind of questions on biomimicry this morning. I know that I've had some interesting topics from people around, you know,
what, how could we find biomimicry and what might we find within it in design. And just while we're driving here, I'll be looking out for any kind of thing that will show you a little bit more about how we can use design in many things. I mean, of course, we could look at trees and understand how water might go up a tree to that of a leaf, how a leaf captures, but I've explained that example a few times. So we can have a look at the shells of beetle and the body structure of a cheetah within design, and the dexterous movability of something that's over there. Hold on. A whole group of warthogs that are moving there. You can just see them through the thicket. There's one there, you can see it. Are you able to see it? They've just moved off. You can just see the ones walking there. There they go. So that, what you saw there, I just saw that in the corner of my eyes, is that tail flicker and help the youngsters, which there were quite a few piglets there, to help them navigate themselves through the bush. And there's an amazing looking male Nyala. And it's just walking out into the thicket there. There we go. So that's the best way you want to see a Nyala, looking through the bushes. That's where they like to be. Their habitat is these woodland areas behind the trees where they can camouflage themselves best, where it's most difficult for them to be seen. So that was a quick little spot of a warthog and an Nyala. Very cool. So there's also, can you hear that? Sound of an oxpecker. That one there. Let's go around. That could often mean that there's a buffalo, or even a hippo or something that could be around the corner. So let's just see what might be around this corner. So that's a very important call to have out here in the bush. Can you actually see that bird? There it is. It's on the top of the tree there. It's an oxpecker. So let's go down. Maybe there should be something beneath this tree. See, the signs in the bush are very, very important. So looking at the tracks and listening to the sounds of the birds, that's also an amazing shot. Have a look at that. If you want to screenshot the look of a bird with the backdrop of those clouds in the distance, it looks really, really beautiful. That's your red-billed oxpecker. A lot about what biomimicry is just stopping and quietening your cleverness. So that's what Janine Benyus, who is from the United States, has taught me, that the more we stay quiet and we listen to what's around us, we can start learning more about the natural ecologies that are all around us. There goes the oxpecker. Biomimicry is basically just another word for learning a little bit more. There goes a red bull buffalo weaver with a whole bunch of twigs in its mouth into the distance. Probably going off to its nest. That was cool. That's from Liam there. So essentially biomimicry is just quietening one's cleverness and stopping to think about what you know. If there's anything that you think you might know, it's just about coming out into the bush and learning more about life. That's it, it's such a complicated word for such a basic thing. It's just about reducing all your assumptions that you have made and just stopping and starting to listen more to the different ecologies that are out there. Here comes the red bull buffalo weaver again. Looks like they are collecting things from here. We're going to see another one coming. There's the one there that's flying there. That could also actually be fork-tailed drongo that I'm seeing there. That's a fork-tailed drongo that just flew into that tree there. There's another bird that's just below there. You can't quite see it at the moment. Awesome.
Brenda, Brenda.
You need seven more birds to reach 100 on your list.
So we just saw the red-billed buffalo weaver,
red-billed drongo. You definitely have those already. We saw the chin spot batis this morning. And let's see if we can find something more. We're going down into a thicker area here. Let's see what we might be able to find down here.
Aqua's just asked the question, asking me, Sam, what has been the field of presenting, what has been the most unexpected part of just starting this? If that was the question, I think that was it from Aqua. And what have I learned?
So what did I learn that I didn't expect to learn?
That's a great question, Aqua. You know, for me,
I wanted to really learn about how we can put things into practice.
So learning
theory. So I've learned all these theories from Gaia theory to deep ecology, systems thinking at university and all of that.
So I came straight out of a master's, straight into the bush to do presenting.
And the unexpected thing is to see how those theories that I've learned are starting to really find their way into practice by learning more about the behavior of animals. Like, I didn't realize that behavior of animals were really going to draw my attention to presenting. In the presenting, and I really want to bring the viewer into the different views and sights and behaviors that we might find in the natural bush, the natural ecology. So Brent is with the warthog. Let's go and have a look at that warthog.
Well, there's a big pig leaving cheetah plans and going to Kruger. So unfortunately, no sign of the cheetah, so I'm pretty sure they've headed south from where they were yesterday. Seems that the sneezes only wait till I'm live to come out. Well, not live, I don't seem to sneeze at all. So a nice big warthog. He's continuing into Kruger at a slow jog. Being followed by a male impala. Let's see if Jean-Dre can spot the impala. Oh, he missed it. Oh, there it is. See it?
No.
A little bit to the left. A little bit more?
Yeah.
Oh, there he is. The male impala. And it's all the boys. Big male warthog, male impala, and a little bit further to the left, Gnormalus's competition, another male wildebeest. So Snoop is wondering how big the open areas of cheetah plains are. I'd say they're probably in total around 150, maybe 175 hectares. They're probably close on 200 acres. So, Gnorman's got all the girls. Shame. This guy hasn't got any at the moment. Let's keep heading down the Kruger. So, unfortunately, as I say that, those are old, though. Those are very old. Yeah. Very old cheetah tracks going into Kruger. Barely visible, in fact. So, we're going to keep checking, and I'm hoping maybe we'll get some luck right along the northern section of Cheetah Plains. Maybe in Kanyinin we'll come down for a visit. But while we do that, Sam has got something who definitely doesn't like seeing leopards.
So So we've just come across some vervet monkeys down here. So you can see there's one holding onto a tree there quite well. There's actually a few of them. There's another one that's standing in the grass. There's one here and there's another one. There's one there. So there's two there, one standing in the grass there, one standing up on the tree, and there's also another one. You can't see right now. It's walking to the left of the tree. Let's watch and see what they do. Monkeys are a great animal to follow, especially out here in the bush, because they will be one of the most reliable animals to tell us that there is a leopard in the area. So they are very, very frightened of leopards. And leopards will kill a monkey. So they'll let us know if there's anything around the area that might be threatening them. So there it goes. Watch the way it runs on the ground. There it goes. This is so cool. Off into the bush there. And that's where they're going. Let's move in that direction. Maybe they'll move off and give us a greater sight and come a little bit closer to us. There's a road not far away from us, which is called Woolbridge Road. They're over there in the distance. Maybe they'll run across our path if we're lucky enough. So they looked fairly relaxed. They don't look like they're making a loud noise, which is what they would say if they were seeing a leopard. Terence Richard is asking, is there any biomimicry to looking at the hooves of an antelope? James, I haven't heard of any emulation or design that's been looked into around the emulation of a hoof structure. I'm sure once you start to look at it, so there's three different ways in which you can view a, there's a little squirrel on the road. Sorry, I love squirrels. Let's have a look and see the squirrel. It's just over there. It's jumping up into the tree now. I'm going to stop. There's the squirrel. You can see its nice thick tail over there. It's gone back into the thicket. So squirrels, so we've just seen a monkey and a squirrel, and those two animals are just great to see in these areas because they are not only, the squirrel's not as reliable as the monkey is when seeing a leopard when there's an alarm call, but a squirrel will also alarm call at a leopard. So there's three different ways in biomimicry you can look. You can look at the emulation, so the actual design of something. And you can look at the system, so the system that it works in and how it contributes to the system. And then you can look at the process. So system, emulation, and process. Or function, you know, what is the actual function of that? So process is, in other words, the safe word is the function. What function does it provide for the animal, and how might that be something positive to learn from? So you can go into your back garden, look at a tree structure, look at a leaf structure, look at the way in which a gecko's tail does this. Look at how does a tree, how is the tree's bark able to help with wind, and how is it able to create, but what is the purpose of bark? How does bark act as a substance or a protection layer? And look at that ant that's calling. Awesome imagery there from Vim. That's so cool. Is that an ant? There are ants. It's just see them, that silhouette of them as they walk. That was very cool. Great little spot from Vim. Spotting a lion this morning to spotting an ant crawling up a tree. You know, you've got to have good eyesight to be able to pick up on these smaller things in life. So that's it. So biomimicry, as I said, it's just a way of seeing. It's a way of learning that is listening. The natural, at least that's the way in which I've picked it up, you know, the way of listening to each individual within the natural world and how it's in relation to everything. I think that's the most powerful thing to learn for me with ecology, is to learn relationship, you know, the relationship of a tree to its ecosystem, the relationship of a monkey to its ecosystem. And then eventually that will help us understand what our relationship is.
J-Rad would like to know what other animals would prey on a leopard. I mean, it's on a vervet monkey. So I just know that the leopard would. But if we go into the book very, very quickly, there is a list of animals that would prey. So 2 or 6. There's the vervet monkey. That's the monkey we just saw. Up on the right there is a nice picture of a vervet monkey. And the enemies are a leopard, a lion, a caracal, and a crowned eagle. So have a look at the enemies, which is over here. So I've never seen a caracal out here in the bush. And that is the one animal I really, really want to see. So they can live up to 12 years, and their main food, double their diet, is wild fruits, flowers, leaves, seeds, insects, birds, and eggs. And they are diurnal animals, so they'll be moving during the day. So what we're going to do is, maybe we get to see the vervet monkeys again if we go up Walbridge Road. Because they were moving in a southerly direction, so that could be exciting to see that monkey again. You know, just going back to that conversation on biomimicry that we were having earlier, is that, you know, my first reaction to biomimicry was the design aspect. It was like, how do we look at a kingfisher's beak that then could be designed to the front of a train to create a train that's more efficient through moving through tunnels and all that sort of stuff, which they've done. If you look up the kingfisher's beak in biomimicry, it's fascinating to see what they've designed from that. But then I just went further and further within that. So it started from the design aspect, and then I went into the ethos of it. And that's essentially what I was going to do my master's in 2 years ago, around the ethical dimensions around biomimicry. And basically, what is the philosophies behind the designs, which for me is the most important part of it. And you start learning a little bit more about biophilia, you know. All these big words for something that just make a little sense. Biophilia is love, you know, like biophobia is like I was scared, like our phobia, you know what a phobia is, scared of something, the fear of something. Biophilia is the love of something. So when we're children, it's said that our biophilic tendency to the natural world is much greater, and we kind of lose that as we grow older, because some say it's the education system that kind of pushes us away from that biophilic tendency. There's some impala over here. Some beautiful impala that are what looks like they're grazing there. So they're both grazers, selective grazers and browsers. So they'll eat grass and they'll eat leaves. And that's a female that we're looking at the moment. Over there. So there's actually two of them there. There's a third one that's walked into the screen. There should be a male not so far away. There's another female that's coming out of the bush here. So there's four females that we've seen. And there should be a nice, big, good-looking male around here. And that's what we call a harem. Harem of females. So a harem is when one male is looking after many, many females. I'm sure that he's in there somewhere, looking after his good-looking group of females. We're going to see if we can find those vervet monkeys again, because I'd love to show you them again. They look so cool when they're climbing trees, so we'll see if we can find them. The time being, let's go and see how Brent is doing tracking cheetahs on cheetah plants.
Well, there's a big grey bottom of a large must bull. You can smell the must quite clearly. He just popped across the road in front of us. It looks like he found something that he wants to snack on. Now, he is in quite a thick area, so we're not going to off-road for a must bull in an area like this. He found something tasty there. I do like these big balls. quite a nice set of ivory. We can't really see it through the bushes, but it looks nice and long and even. You see that glimpse of white every now and then. Breaking those branches. I'm going to try and move a little bit, see if we can get a slightly better view. Does it say when if you get a good gap, Chandra?
Yeah, probably the best for you.
Jan would like to know, do elephant tusks grow from their skull? Well, they do grow from inside their skull, and about a third of an elephant tusk is actually inside its body that we can't see. And you can just see that gleaming ivory through the bush. Hiding behind her. Which bush willow, Jandre?
Variable.
Red. So Jandre has asked to be taught some bush willows this morning. So the red bush willow, the most common bush willow we get in this area. Actually, I'm going to leave that LEB. I don't think he's going to give us much better of a view. But what we can do is look at some bush willows for Jandre. So Jandre seems to have got this bush willow down.
Russet.
Oh, there we go. Russet bush willow with a very rusty looking seeds. But let's find the red bush willow quickly. Or a leaf of one at least. Here we go. It is the most common tree in both Juma and cheetah plants. And we'll take one leaf from there, another leaf from there. So the best way to remember a red bush willow, if you're ever out there and you're unsure, of course it doesn't look too red. The heartwood is very red and it's actually one of the most dense trees. If we had to put a piece of bush willow in water, or red bush willow, it would sink. It's actually more dense than leadwood. So I'm going to pop that on the dashboard for Jandre. Now, sometimes it's not that obvious, but always the red bush willow leaves have a little sharp edge, a little pick almost. It looks like the little sharp edge of a pick on the end of their leaf. And if you ever want to remember the scientific name for the red bush willow, it is a Combretum, which is the bush willow family, Apiculatum. So you just remember that little pick on the edge of the leaves and that should help you remember it. Combretum Apiculatum. We will be keeping an eye out for other bush willows for Jandre on the way home. So we do have quite a few species. And some of them are quite common, some of them not so much. But probably the three most common that we see regularly are the red, the variable, and...
Leadwood.
Leadwood, but and the russet. So those are the four most common. Leadwood is also a bush willow. Joyce in Minnesota is wondering whether our leaves change colour in the fall. So, well, Joyce, we don't have a real traditional fall, but our leaves do change colour and fall off on certain species. Now, we've got a perfect example of this at the moment. There's a red bush willow with the leaves turning and they will fall off. And even the marula to the left has also started turning. So some of the trees will lose their leaves and change colour. But we do have a few evergreens that don't. Oh, Jandre, there's another bush willow for you. Now, let's see, Jandre, which one is that?
This one?
No, That's a red at the back. It's this one here.
A baby.
A baby. It is a variable bush willow, a Combretum calinum. Called variable because it has variable sized leaves and variable sized fruit, and can quite often be confused with the large fruited bush willow, which has very big leaves and very big fruit. But a variable can have both. What you want to look at is just sort of the general size and the shape. The variable sort of more, I mean, the large fruit is more shaggy and much thicker. The variable is a little bit more sparse and generally a bit taller. Now there are a few of the, well, not rare, but rare in our area, Combretums that we can look for. One is called Combretum erythrophyllum, and that is the river bush willow. And then one of my favorites is Combretum molle, which is the velvet bush willow. And the leaves are very velvety and silky. Quickly, Jandre, general size, shape and impression of the tree.
Not a baby.
Not a baby. It's another variable.
Right.
I'll try to show you a large fruited to give you an idea between the two. That always makes life a bit easier when you've got something to compare against. As I was saying, we don't really have that sort of fall and spring period. We go straight from sort of, we've got really two seasons. We've got wet and hot and dry and cold. So we have a sort of a winter and a summer. But in terms of seasons, it's much easier to discern the seasons out here in Africa as wet and dry. J-Rad says, after looking at that elephant, wondering if they ever get sunburned. They don't. I mean, they've got that incredibly dark skin and very thick and large subcutaneous fat there. So they're very well insulated and protected against the sun. And you'll notice our leaves will turn at different times depending on rainfall. So you'll find certain areas will, the leaves will all turn far before others. Excuse me. That was a big one. What did you see? Ah, there we go. There's a false marula that's busy turning. So very, very pretty. You can see the green and yellow of the turning leaves. While we continue on to try find a large fruited bush willow for Jandre, let's go see what Sam's up to.
We have just come across some small looking mongoose. They've been jumping and running around there for the last minute or so. Just gonna have a look and see if we can find these mongoose again.
Stop
for us. Found them. I think they could be.
Right there.
There they are. We found them. They're just at that hole there. Well, for the time being, we've got a squirrel on the right. It's just left us. Still there. You can still see it. So that's our second squirrel of the morning, and now the dwarf mongoose are all out. This is awesome, look at that.
6 of them there. So they'll probably be coming out to nibble on some food, and dwarf mongooses will move from place to place to go and find new homes. That helps them, the diversity of homes helps them get away from the different predators that like to follow them. If there was an owl that kept on coming here, it would slowly kill off all these little mongoose. And it seems that they've just found a home here. I love dwarf mongoose, they're very, very interesting creatures. I'm still yet to see a dwarf mongoose with an egg, trying to open an egg. Apparently it's one of the funniest things you can see, watching a dwarf mongoose with an egg. So you get a sentinel mongoose, which means the one that will look out for any predators, and he'll be just a little bit further away from where they might be feeding or doing something within the den, and will let everyone know if there is a predator in the area. So there he is. Look how sweet you are. There's now just one of them. What are you up to? What are you going to do? See how he just lifted his head there? You can see those eyes. Prominent dark eyes there. So they're the smallest of the mongoose. So their feeding habits. They like to eat all sorts of insects and all the different things out here in the bush. There's one that just jumped out there. You often see mongoose with hornbills, actually. There's a nice symbiosis between a hornbill and a mongoose, where a mongoose will come out and start feeding on some insects, such as scorpions and whatnot. And then a hornbill will come, and they actually have a relationship so that the hornbill will make a very loud noise, an alarm call to say that there's a predator in the area. And in that situation, the mongoose will then go back into the den. But sometimes, which is interesting, I think it's happened up in the Kalahari, you'll have like a fork-tailed drongo that will mimic, because drongos are mimickers, and they can mimic the sounds of other birds, and they will mimic, I think they do it with meerkats, which is interesting, and they'll mimic that call. They'll see that the mongoose has just found a scorpion, mimic that call, and then the hornbill will go down and the drongo will go down and eat that scorpion, which is quite interesting. But the relationship, the symbiosis between the hornbill and the mongoose is actually a positive one. So it's mutual, where the mongoose will provide the food, some of the food for the hornbill, and the hornbill will act as an alarm system for those mongoose. So that's a fascinating thing if we get to see that one day. It seems that it's a little bit more empty now. It doesn't look like they're here anymore. Well, there looks like some grass moving in the background there, so could be something going on behind that little termite mound there. So they often find they'll live in termite mounds, in old unused termite mounds, because you see that grass shaking on the other side there. I don't know what they're doing. I'm going to drive it a little bit forward. There's one in the background. It's moving around. So they have to be careful of all sorts of predators out here. I'm actually going to have a look here on the dwarf mongoose. I'm going to show you, because I know someone wanted to see the track of a mongoose. So let's show you the track of... It's James Richard that wanted to see tracks of a mongoose. There we go. So if we go down to the mongooses here, yellow, slender, Cape Grey, white-tailed, dwarf mongoose there. At the bottom is the dwarf mongoose. So that's the track of the dwarf mongoose. Very, very small. It's only around plus minus 2 centimeters, where you'll find that the other mongooses are quite a lot larger. The one that we see at night time, we often see it on the road, is this one, the white-tailed mongoose. And that's what we would have seen the other day, James, if you're here. We would have seen on the road the white-tailed mongoose. So, slender mongoose is this one over here, which is the gregarious, the mongoose that lives in groups such as the is the one that we're looking here at, the dwarf mongoose. And there's actually an interesting little thing that they say about slender mongoose, is that if you on your way to work, it doesn't matter where you are, if you're on the way to work and the slender mongoose crosses your track, you have to go all the way back home because something might have happened at home. So whenever, even if you're off to the shops and the slender mongoose runs across you, it's a sign to say go home. So it's an interesting little story about that. But I just thought, let's maybe also have a look while we're here. Have a look at the watering hole here. See if there's any birds on the side there while I quickly go and get onto the page of the dwarf mongoose. And we can learn a little bit more of the dwarf mongoose while we're here with it. Elaine would like to know how many other, how many different types of monkeys we get here, but I'm going to come back to that in a second. Let's just quickly have a look here at the dwarf mongoose. You can see the track then again here, so it's plus minus 2.5 centimeters. And interestingly, let's have a look at the type of food that they eat. So we spoke about scorpions and insects, so they eat locusts and worms. Very, very interesting. So that's what they like to eat, and that's also what the hornbill likes to eat, so that's why they have that grouping together. And the animals that like to eat that are the leopard, the civet, the African wildcat, jackals, python, and African hawk eagle. So that's who the dwarf mongoose needs to be quite careful of. So going back to that question around the monkeys that we get in this area, we have the of course the vervet monkey. That's from Elaine. Of course the vervet monkey, as well as the we get a baboon. Those are the two monkeys that we get in this area that I've seen. The baboon is much harder to find. If we see a baboon and we get time to sit with it, we're very, very lucky. It's much easier to find a vervet monkey. Where I lived in the Cedarburg Mountains out by Cape Town is where I used to see baboons all the time, where they are quite wild. And in Cape Town, they can be quite of a problem, especially at Cape Point. If you ever go to Cape Point, don't ever feed a baboon at Cape Point, because you know, there's a bit of a problem there with baboons and people feeding them, and then they start attacking people to get food now, which is a problem. And there's the dwarf mongoose again, so we've had such a lucky display of them this morning, moving around, jumping from place to place. And they are gregarious, as I said, so they'll move together in their little groups. So those are the mongoose. Let's go. We don't have much time left on drive, so I thought, you know, we might as well just drive around here to see if we can find any more tracks of potentially some leopard that's walked in the area. Let's go and see how Brent is doing. Brent is with a large animal again, much like Mr. Ellie.
Look at this, another beautiful big must bull. Really nice ivory on him as well. His right side is longer than his left. In his prime, probably mid-30s. He's got a very distinct hole in his ear there. There you go. And a little nick, a sort of triangular nick and a hole. Causing us a bit of a traffic jam. Feeding off a terminalia at the moment. Or a silver cluster leaf. Let's just try edge a little bit closer. Oh, there's another big bull behind him. A little bachelor's group going on here. What a wonderful way to end this sunrise safari with some big Ellie bulls. just see from his body language how relaxed he is. His tail swinging loosely. Lovely big bull. Look at that ivory. That is a magnificent right tusk he's got. Quite long, I'd say, sure. Might be one of the longest single pieces of ivory we've seen, Archer. Nice curve on it. I would guess that's probably, that's quite a bit over a meter. That's probably closer to a meter and a half. It sounds like there's quite a few other elephants around as well. Oh, excuse me. They're so peaceful. And this is one of the benefits of this very dry time we're having, is this influx of massive elephant bulls. He's moved on from the cluster leaf. He's now eating a zebra wood. And you can see that little buildup of white gunk in his eye. And what we would probably call sleep, but probably from dust and other stuff as he moves around. And the eye cleaning itself. Well, tomorrow we'd like to know if this is the same elephant with a hole in its ear that we've seen before. I've never seen this guy before. Jandre, while I've been away, have you seen him? No, nope, Jandre hasn't seen him either. He's a nice big Ellie. Really making short work of that little zebra wood. Big bull like this eats around 200 kilograms of vegetable matter in a day. That's over 400 pounds of food. And keep a monster like this in good condition. You can now see why his left tusk is slightly shorter. That's his working tusk. So he's left-handed. You can see there's a little break and stuff on it. So he uses that to break branches and peel bark. And so it's worn down a bit more than the right. There we go. You can see him utilizing that left tusk there. But what a wonderful way to end the sunset safari, a sunrise safari. Sam and I will be with you in a few short hours for the sunset safari, and hopefully we'll have lots more big Ellie bulls and other creatures around. And for the last little bit of the sunrise safari, let's have a look at this wonderful big bull.